Not sure if you've heard, but we might be entering into a trade war with China. It might help to understand what the other side's troops have, because in a story that isn't getting reported much, China might not be doing as hot as everyone's thinking. With their stock market collapsed $406 billion on June 19th. To put that in perspective, 1,023 companies in China fell by 10% of their value that day. And that week, their overall stock market lost the equivalent to Sweden's yearly GDP. And Sweden, well, they make a lot of stuff. So what happened June 19th in America?
An angry Donald Trump escalated the trade fight with Beijing late Monday. He's now threatening to slap his largest tariffs yet on Chinese goods to the tune of $200 billion worth of products.
Now, the sudden stock market collapse that dropped faster than the bass in a Skrillex song has inspired the Chinese government to leap into action with all kinds of immediate reforms. Because they don't have a Congress that makes it so that you only get to the solution about a year after the problem has resolved itself. So what have they done? Well, they really called on every branch of the government to solve this problem, starting with China's four state-owned financial newspapers printed editorials telling investors to keep calm. China A stocks do not have the basis for sustained decline. Call me a cynic, but I don't think it's a good sign when every one of your state-owned newspapers runs the same headline, "Everything is fine!" That was after the June 19th collapse we talked about earlier. Alright, now the rest of the changes are a little more substantial. China's central bank on Sunday lowered the required reserve ratio, unlocking about 700 billion yuan or $108 billion of liquidity. Now, this is a risky move because while it does free up some money to invest in companies, banks are about as fiscally responsible as a teenage girl with their parents' credit card. Basically, what this means is the government is saying, "Hey banks, guess what? You don't need to hold back or save as much money as you used to. So, go ahead and loan it out or invest it." You know, the same type of banking regulation that led to the thriving economy we had in 2005. No regrets there. The problem with allowing banks to make it rain for economic stimulation is that if their investments fail, or too many people want to get their money from the banks at once, well, I'm not sure an IOU from Lehman Brothers is exactly going to give anyone much comfort nowadays. Now, we can already see the results of these changes because, as Bloomberg reported on June 24th, while the Shanghai Composite Index opened higher after a widely expected reserve ratio cut by the central bank, those gains gave way to a 1% slump by the close. Great. So this had about as much impact on the economy as Donald Trump saying,
"And some, I assume, are good people,"
had on making Democrats think he's not racist. So what else did they do? Well, Chinese regulators told brokerages last week to seek government approval before dumping large chunks of pledged stock. Despite the fact that this is a bit confusing, if your gut's telling you that this isn't good, then congratulations. Either your gut is 100% correct, or you're still feeling the impact of a late-night Taco Bell binge. 12% of China's stock market is being held as collateral, which is great if the markets are going up, but when the thing drops, whoo man, are you gonna feel it. Basically, the sudden plummet in stock prices is making the collateral worth so much less than the loaned money that, if the companies who received the loan can't provide more, well, then the lending company will sell their stocks and just keep crashing the market. For this reason, you now have to apply for approval to sell off stocks. And I'm not saying that's gonna be a challenge, but I think it might be faster and easier to just fix the entire Chinese economy than get a yes stamp from the feds. Basically, you're stuck with those failing stocks until China figures out what to do. And boy oh boy does that increase the value of the stock market, because when I see people being legally forced into keeping their stocks, that just makes me want to jump at the opportunity to get in on all of that action. So what else are they doing? At least 101 Chinese firms on June 20th and 21st said major shareholders and executives plan to increase their stakes or have bought shares according to exchange filings. Yes, if demand outside your company has slipped for your stocks, well then increase that demand by demanding them all yourself. For example, property developer Guangzhou Yuetai Group Company's chairman plans to buy up 1 billion yuan or $154 million of the company's shares. Hey, at least someone has faith in these companies. This is less of a CEO single-handedly trying to keep his company afloat, like the guy with the bucket trying to scoop all of the water out of the Titanic. And instead, it's more of a show that, hey investors, I like making money, and I'm gonna risk 1 billion of my own yuan gambling on my company. So don't worry, I'll make sure to put forward a pro-investor policy so we can all make a fortune. The next thing you have China doing is the People's Bank of China governor, Yi Gang, who generally talks about as much as Clarence Thomas after having his tonsils removed, came out to say to Chinese investors, "Remain calm, the central bank will use monetary policy comprehensively to counteract any outside shocks." Again, it's never a great sign when someone who barely ever speaks publicly comes out to declare that, nothing's really going on here. What he went on to say is that the collapse of stock market prices is mostly driven by investor sentiment, which might be true. Although, in the same sentence, he talked about the need for all kinds of monetary and policy tools and fighting all sorts of trade friction. And, I wonder what he could be talking about there. I think I have a perfect strategy for combating the trade war, though. Have you tried investing a few $1 million in Trump National LLC? Trust me, it will do wonders for your country economy come negotiating time. So there's one final thing China's doing to fight off this sudden stock market collapse. Making it rain on them companies. And I'm not talking about how I'll walk into a club with 5 ones and some quarters and make it drizzle with a chance of hail. Nah, we're talking torrential downpour with, just so far this June, the People's Bank of China has already injected another 200 billion yuan or $31 billion into the economy on Tuesday via its medium-term lending facility. Combine that with the funds it added earlier this month and that's a net injection of 403.5 billion yuan so far in June. And that was written on the 19th, so we still have a third of a month to make Obama's bailout look like leaving a penny in Goldman Sachs' tip jar. Now, read into this statement as much as you'd like, but that's a lot of money for a consumer confidence issue. So, they're increasing the amount of money they're putting into the system, but how are they doling it out? It's not as though they have an investor hotline you can call into if you're unsure of the market to get a check for a few million dollars. Instead, China's central bank broadened the range of collateral it accepts in its medium-term lending operations. Now, this gets unnecessarily specific and complicated, so I'm gonna simplify it a little bit. Basically, the Chinese bank announced that they will buy stocks of reliable smaller companies, green technology, and corporate bonds. The reason for doing this is pretty clear. It makes the stocks that plummeted most seem most attractive to investors, as well as trying to help smaller lenders with riskier stocks and bonds not fail. So, why worry about smaller lenders getting money? Well, this is about to go full circle and seems like such a terrible idea. These small lenders own a lot of debt, and in the coming years are gonna have a lot of loans from the Chinese central bank expire, and they might not be able to pay it off, especially with plummeting stock values. China's solving this by accepting some of those stocks and bonds, and lowering the reserve requirements we talked about earlier, so that Chinese lenders can hold less cash and use what they previously were required to hold to pay back their debts to the Chinese government. And it's never a good sign when you need to lower the reserve requirements because the lenders are all of a sudden running low on money because of all of their bad investments, which is the exact reason those reserve requirements were put into the banks in the first place. We need to access this cash because all of the cash we had is now gone. Now, to be clear, it's not like we're doing perfectly here.
U.S. stock index futures remaining sharply lower this morning. The Dow down 355 points. That's what it'll look like at the open. This after President Trump threatens to slap more tariffs on China.
So, I don't want to seem like the pot calling the kettle black, but can we just throw up the two markets to compare them over the last 2 years? Oof, look at that drop since the U.S.-China trade relations fell apart. Now, I want to explicitly state that this is not me planting my flag in camp China's gonna lose the trade war. It's just a gaping hole that somehow has been completely absent in all of the reporting on this conflict so far. We're not yet sure if this trade war will give us jobs or good deals, but we can now guarantee that it will ruin a ton of lives. Before I go, I feel kind of obligated to give a shout out to Bloomberg. Bloomberg Magazine for this episode. You guys were in the main ones to cover this, so I mainly use you guys for research. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello, YouTube. If you want to support nonpartisan comedic reporting, please subscribe to my channel and like below. As always, thank you for watching.